So during the Bully Beatdown era, how did you even pick the bullies or pick the fighters? How did you put this whole show together?
You know, the whole thing was, you know, I was lucky enough to a major production. Mark Burnett Productions was like in charge of that. So it wasn't an MTV show. It was Mark Burnett sold that to MTV. So he is from Survivor and The Apprentice. This guy made Trump the president, so you guys can blame him for that. The friggin'
I love Trump.
Everyone loves Trump. Me too. I'm just saying, you know what I mean? The liberal media out there. And anyway, the friggin' production staff was huge. And I can't believe it got made, because on day one of like the testing, they wanted to see. There was some nerdy producer, this poor guy, went to Legends. Remember Legends? It was great, great gym.
Yeah. And Chris Riley.
Chris Riley. Mm-hmm. I hollered at him the other day.
Yeah, I saw him. We went to Columbia recently.
I got a kick with him. But anyway, the first day of like screen testing, this kind of thing, this guy's like, all right, I kind of want to see what MMA, this skinny dude. And some kid jumps guard on the guy, and the guy snaps his leg like a chicken bone, snaps his leg on the first day of screen testing. And somehow that it still got made. Yeah. They were like, ah, oh, that's a fluke. That won't happen again. And it didn't. You know what I mean? Like, we put some tough bully guys. And what happened, I think, was they had a Craigslist, straight up like casting call to a Craigslist. Do you have a bully? Are you a bully? Do you want to be on a show? Do you think you could fight a professional mixed martial arts fighter? And a lot of guys do.
So even it wasn't to this scripted. Day. It wasn't scripted.
Well,
it wasn't staged.
I mean, come on. We all know at this point, back then they didn't know. But we know at this point, you have to have some story beats. Like, you have to have some amount of scripting. You know, I think the reason that show took off was me chatting with the guy and taking advantage of my quick, like, the fact that we could do an interview for about an hour and cut that down into 6 minutes. And I would say some funny shit. So it's not scripted in the traditional sense, but you know, we had to have a beginning, middle, and end. And the fight was, I would tell the guys, hey man, carry this dude. Please don't just knock him out immediately, because what the hell? There's no show if you just knock this guy out in the first 30 seconds.
You some know? Of those guys deserve this shit.
Yeah, I know. So, but here's the thing too, is that in the beginning, dude, it was the Wild West. Like, no script really, because we didn't know how it was going to work. We didn't know what the hell was going to happen. It was like a weird kind of, and the people didn't know what the hell they were doing. By season three, you had like pro wrestlers on there. Like, you know what I mean? They knew what the game was and they played it up. I think it really got better and better as the seasons went on, because by the time, you know, like the last episode was some guys that, or like not the last, the last episode we filmed was like a guy who was like a pro wrestler. Like, he just totally knew how to talk shit. He knew, and that's kind of the era that we're in now with mixed martial arts, is that, you know, guys know how to market themselves. Like, me and you were early on that, saying funny stuff on the interview, kind of let our personality shine. We could have just went out there and, oh, I'm going to fight, but we wouldn't let ourselves. We both came from the days of WWF, yeah, where you have to put on a good promo to get everybody hyped up for your match. Yeah. And that's what we did. And now that's just, it's gone to the next level where even guys who aren't into that, like, their management says, hey man, hype this up. So yeah, you get these weird cringe ass moments, but you know, that's how it was destined to be that way.